Am I audible, everybody? Okay, today's goal is to not only showcase the way you can decompile different applications of various platforms ranging from Android, iOS, BlackBerry, Windows Phone, the latest one. I'll not only show you how to do that, but I want you to learn, you know, how a normal guy approaches it. Let's say tomorrow you have a challenge. Go and decompile a Windows Phone app. What do you do first? You know, the methodology, the method that a pen tester takes to research and develop a decompilation process. So that is what I want to teach you today. That is the most important part, okay? The processes, let's say for iOS, Android, Windows Phone, BlackBerry, the processes, the tools used, everything is there on the slides. I'll be showing you demonstrations. The presentation is going to be mostly demonstrations. But before the demonstration, I want to distribute. I'll be lecturing you for 5 to 10 minutes about what is the method, how did I come about it, you know, how did I invent the process, or how did I find out if the process was existing, you know, what were the challenges, so that all of you are in the same line, and when you go back and somebody tells you, go and decompile a Windows Phone, you know how to do it, even if you don't have the slides. Okay? So that's going to be my target. Okay? So quickly going through the initial slides. Takeaway for the day, why mobile security? Most of you must be aware of the same. Purpose of decompiling will be learned. Methodology of decompilation, the method. This is the most important slide of the day. Live demos. So these are like, you know, just examples or practical scenarios in which I have achieved the same. Clear? So please don't bother. Please ask me questions whenever you are not clear. Okay? Okay, why mobile security? 5 years down the line, I was pen testing web applications. 2 years down the line, I saw most of the people who had developed web applications initially, they ended up building mobile apps. So the same people who had sent me web applications to test, they started sending me mobile applications. And there were different types of mobile applications, like Facebook, m.facebook.com is a web browser-based mobile application. Then you have Facebook apps for different platforms. So these applications started coming. So why mobile? Because it is the next big thing. Clear? Statistics of mobile users. Now this slide is very important to understand why I'm showing Android, why I'm showing iOS, why I'm showing Windows. So it shows over here the increase from 2011 to 2012. Android, iOS, Symbian, Research in Motion, that is BlackBerry, Microsoft Phone and Microsoft Mobile. Windows Phone, Windows Mobile. Clear? So just statistics, you must all have seen this before. From this slide we can see that most of the users or most of the applications that are there in the market are usually games, weather, navigation, social networking, banking and finance, 28%. Everybody goes home and you do transactions. Everybody wants to do it on their mobile phones. Everybody has stopped using net banking. Okay? So this is one important point. 28% of the apps in the market are of banking and finance. And when there's an app in the market, it has to be secured. Clear? A feature phone is, there are certain applications which are built for specific phones, not a smartphone. Let's say you get a second authentication pin on your phone, an SMS, to do a second factor authentication, that becomes a feature phone app. Clear? You have an RSA application, instead of a gadget, you use an RSA application on your phone, that becomes a feature phone app. Clear? Next slide, please. Okay, so different types of mobile applications. So before I go into detail, let us understand what are the different types of mobile applications available in the market. So mobile browser-based applications. I'm sure everybody knows what are browser-based applications. Example, m.facebook.com. Any application which has been built to work on a mobile browser in a very lightweight fashion is called a mobile browser-based application. Clear? Next is a native mobile application. You can analogously map it to an EXE. You go home, you click on an EXE, it installs on your Windows operating system. So this is an application which has been built specific to a platform. So a native mobile application is any application built specific to Android, iOS, BlackBerry, Windows Phone. So let's say tomorrow you say there is an application called Facebook.apk. An APK is an extension for Android application. So this application has been natively coded in the Android IDE and has been built for the Android phone. So it becomes a native mobile application. Next is a hybrid mobile application. Anybody aware of what is a hybrid application? Anybody over here? You want to help me out with it? Hybrid?
Combination of the two. If browser and native are made.
Cool. That's great. Anybody else? So somebody raised their hand again.
Okay.
Web view. Web view. Perfect. So any native application that has been built, let's say, example, GTalk. Okay. You go home, you start your GTalk. Does it always show you the same set of contacts? It doesn't. It real time gets a set of contacts from the server. So it has a web view part of it, which dynamically changes every time. So that is an example of a hybrid application. Yeah. So these are three different types of mobile applications. We'll be seeing screenshots to understand them in detail. Now this is an example of a Citibank mobile application installed in a Nokia phone. It's a .jar native application built in Java development environment. This is a browser-based application of Bank of America, which can be opened on the mobile browser. You can see the URL bar moving. Now, the difference between a hybrid app and a browser app. A browser app, you hit the URL, the entire thing loads. Clear? And when you see a hybrid app, you can see the native framework over here, inside which the things keep changing. So this becomes the hybrid application. Everybody clear on different types of applications? Now, which applications can be decompiled? Can we decompile web applications? No, you cannot. You don't have it on your phone, right? You cannot remove the exe and decompile, correct? Can you decompile hybrid? Yes, you can. What is the success ratio of finding loopholes? Very, very less, because most of the hybrid features are web features. It's a mixture of web and native, right? And can you decompile native applications? Yes, you can. And what will be the success ratio of finding loopholes? 100%. Clear? So these are three types of applications and which applications you can decompile. So browser-based, yes, no, etc. Okay, so just going through a little more of basics, we have jumped to the main presentation slide. It says, what do you mean by decompilation? For people who don't know over here, I just want to brief them quickly. What do you mean by compilation? Okay, how many of you are from development background, please? Oh, that's awesome. And mobile development? Okay, it's more or less the same. How many of you are smartphone users? No, most of them. Oh, that's great. Okay, so what do you mean by decompilation for those who are not from development background? You must be knowing what is a program. A developer goes, he writes a few lines, it executes something. It gives you an output. So to understand decompilation, let us understand compilation first. Compilation is a process in which you write a program, you use an application or a compiler which you translate it into object code and then to bring out an exe. You use an exe on your Windows machines, so that is the executable, okay? And that has come out from a developer's program. And there's an in-between code known as the object code, byte code, assembly, anything you call it, okay? So these three are the very important steps. Please listen to this and understand this very carefully. Program, byte code or assembly language, and then comes the executable. This concept is very important for anybody who has to understand how to decompile an application. Clear? These three steps? Okay. So what is compilation? Program, object code, and exe. Decompilation, exe, object code, and you bring out the program. So when you're going in the opposite direction, you are decompiling the application. Clear? Now what do you mean by reverse engineering? Anybody, what do you mean by reversing? Quick. Okay, reversing is and the overall process. Okay? You decompile the application, you take the exe, you bring out the code, you change the code, and you recompile it and launch it in the market as a malicious or a malware application. Clear? Everybody clear what is reverse engineering, what is compilation, what is decompilation? Excellent. Okay, now the questions that we're going to answer ahead are, what are the goals and purpose of cracking the code? What do you achieve from this? What do I, as a pen tester, achieve when I crack my client's applications? What is the methodology of decompilation? Star, double star, triple star, whatever, this is the most important slide. What tools can be used? Okay, how do you find out the different tools that can be used? Can decompilation be done on all platforms? Yes, it can. Limitations are there. Challenges are there. Okay, fine. So let's go to the next slide. Goal of cracking the mobile application. What do you achieve after decompiling an application? Tomorrow, a client like Bank Muscat or Bobbin Bank, UAE, or Indian Bank, State Bank of India, they send me their applications and I decompile. There is a test case called decompilation. Why do I do that? What is the goal? What is the goal behind doing such a test case? Playing such a test case? It is to find the treasure keywords. Okay, now this is a part of the process. First thing that I do is I try and understand how the application works. To explain it to you further detail, let's say Facebook.com, you're using a Facebook.com application on your phone. Okay, the first screen asks you for the user ID and password, right? Okay, so let's say you have switched off your Wi-Fi, you switched off your 4G or 3G networks. Okay, you enter the username and password and still it logs you in. Clear? You're not giving it network access and still it is logging you in. So this is a client side check. It is happening in the phone. The check is happening in the phone. You give it internet access, it goes to the server and checks. So these are two different types of applications. One application where the checks are happening locally and the other application where the checks are happening at the server end. Data is being sent to the server. So I wanted to explain to you what do you mean by client side checks. So client side checks are any check that can happen locally on your phone. Okay, so by decompiling the application, you can remove these if statements, load it again and then play it. So if it's a banking application and you don't have a login check, you will be able to see the beneficiary details, the account numbers of all your friends you have loaded on the phone. It's visible. You have removed the check, you have removed the password check. Everybody with me? Am I clear? So you have bypassed client side checks, that is local checks. So that's one very big thing. So it says bypassing the client side checks by rebuilding the app. Clear? You remove the if, you compile it again, you reverse engineer and you build a new app. Okay, and okay, now to find one simple example, let me explain these three scenarios. The first is password in banking application. Now, I don't want to name the client. We were doing pen testing of a particular bank, for a particular bank. They had four different types of applications, BlackBerry, Android, iOS, and then .jar for Java, same deal. So all these applications, they had password. The password belonged to a database. So they had SQL statements which were connecting straight to the server. So after decompiling, I could see the passwords. Clear? So this is a very sensitive information that is hard-coded in the code, which should not be present. So by decompiling, you can perform this test case. So you have to search for all these keywords. Password, algorithm keys, AES keys, SQL information if there's a connection string with password, then what are the different types of algorithms used, etc. etc. So there's a lot of things that you can learn about the application after decompiling it. So the best way is once you decompile, you go on the search feature of the folder. You have all the Java files or all the iOS Cocoa files in that particular folder. You start searching for these keywords. The moment you find any, you know there's a loophole. Clear? Okay, Angry Birds malware. Now this is another example of reverse engineering. The attacker downloaded the Angry Birds app, APK. That time the application was not obfuscated. So he removed the code, he made changes and he uploaded it back. And while you were playing the game, it was sending your personal information to the attacker's server. Is this vulnerable? Is this a malware? Yes, it is. Third, Zitmo malware. Zitmo, this was a malware which spread in the market. Okay, even this was behind a game. We downloaded the malware, we reverse engineered it, and we saw that it was sending premium SMSs to a specific number. Every time it sent an SMS, $3 were getting deducted. You were charged. So this is another example. You can understand the way an application works by decompiling it, basically. Yeah? So you'll understand if a client application is accessing your personal information. Is it accessing your UDID? Is it accessing your hardware ID? Is it reading some folder which it is not supposed to read? So these test cases can be played. Okay? So this is basically the goal. Methodology. So I said, very important step. Please give your 100% attention in this slide. This is very important. How do you decompile an application? Be it any platform, how do you decompile? Okay? The first thing, you gain access to the executable. Okay? So as the step goes, the developer code, the object code, and the exe. So you gain access to the exe. Okay? Then understand the technology used to code the application. Has it been developed in Java? Is it coded in C, C#, Cocoa for iOS, BlackBerry language, .mod files? Then what else? Windows Phone C#. Which language is it using? What is the technology? Is it .NET? Okay. So You need to understand what technology it is using. The next step is find out ways to derive the object code from the executable. Like I said, executable, object code, and program. So the secret is, the secret of decompilation is, any executable that you have, the object code is always hidden inside it, in one way or the other. Make a note of that. The object code, be it whichever technology, is hidden inside the executable. Okay? So the first step, the way you attack, of the way you decompile, is you first find out the object code. You have to search and see, find out which is the object code. There'll be plenty of files. Okay? You unzip it, you WinRAR it, you use various tools to open it, and you find the object code. Okay? So once you have got this object code, you know it's built from a program. Okay? So you have to find packages which will translate it back. That's it. And all these packages are available worldwide, openly, open source packages. Clear? Everybody clear? So the first step is to get the object code from the executable, and it's an open secret that object code is always inside the executable folder. Okay? So once you have the object code, the next step is to simply find a retranslator. Okay? So once you've done that, once you've got the object code, try and figure out a way to find the class files. Okay? Now in the class files, there are various variables. Let's say you're doing writing a simple program for layman. Let's say you're writing a simple program to do a login check. So the class files will have variables like user ID, password, and a function or a method which uses these two parameters to execute it or to perform a check. So the class files will reveal the variables. It will not reveal the functions. Okay? So once you remove the class files from the object code, it will give you the variables. It will not give you the function. It will give you the function names max. Okay? So the next step is to find the function. Okay? So while I'm showing the demonstration, you will make a note that in the iOS platform, max I could go till now is to get the class files. I could not come to the functions. Clear? So the developers, they use various techniques of hiding different parts of the code. In iOS 6, they have managed to obfuscate the entire thing. Till now, I have not decompiled iOS 6 applications. Very difficult. It's not working in the way I used to do it for iOS 5, iOS 4. Okay, so I have to find a new way out. Yeah. So this is going to be the method. First, you download the iOS or any application. Then you find the technology that it's using, making use of. Then you find out the object code. And then you find a way of getting the class files and the function codes out. Clear? So today evening you can go, and if somebody gives you a challenge, decompile this. So there is a method that you follow. Yeah? Okay, so let us jump to demos. The first demo I chose was to show you the Windows Phone, how simple it has been to decompile the Windows Phone app. It's the latest one that was launched in the market. So I'll just quickly go through this. If you know how to decompile DLLs, it's over. Okay, so the slide tells it all. Now, each and every platform, I've prepared a similar slide. It shows which are the tools that I used to decompile, the steps, in short, and the demo that I'll be showing you, and the mitigation. Okay, now the mitigation part is very important. I'll be sharing the slides, so no issues, I'll be sharing it. So, what do you mean by, let me explain the mitigation first. You have decompiled an application, you see various lines. Okay, you see various functions, you see variable names, you see methods, you see keys, you see passwords stored. How does a developer patch these? Okay, there's a technique called obfuscation. Obfuscating a code is basically, in short, let's say there's a function called password check. Okay, you convert this to ABCDEF. That's it. So this is called obfuscation. Clear? There are open source packages available in the market, free of cost, very good packages, which can be used to obfuscate most of the code of any platform. So I mentioned the URLs in each slide. You know, for Windows Phone, you can use this one. Okay, there's a free and there's a paid. In other platforms, I mentioned the links over there. So when you get all of the slides, you can go through them and recommend your developers, or whenever you're giving a solution, you can give them a good read of reading this particular link and using it to obfuscate the code. Clear? So the mitigation part is very important. So that's the whole point of taking the training. After showing you how to decompile it, you have to give them a recommendation, right? So mitigation is the part. Okay, so quickly go into Windows Phone. What is the extension of a Windows Phone app? Windows Phone users? Nobody using Windows Phone? Okay. That's why it says 2.6%. Okay, fine. Okay, so it's a .xap. The extension is .xap. Like we have .exe for Windows platforms. We have .xap for Windows Phone platforms. There was an initial Windows mobile platform you must have heard of, Windows Mobiles, the HTC ones. So that used .jar files, very basic Java files. I'll show you how to do that also, but I'm not mentioning it anywhere in my slides because they are outdated. Nobody uses those anymore. Okay, so .xap is the file name for a Windows Phone executable. Okay, so what did I teach you? You have an exe. What do you bring out? Object code. So any object code that has come after the program, so here it is called .dll. Clear? I learnt about the technology, .NET. .NET produces what? Whenever you're creating an executable in .NET, it gives you .dll. Similarly, Java, .jar, Android.dex. So you have to read about the language. That's why I told you to read about the technology. Once you have read about the technology, you'll know. So .xap to .dll, .dll to .cs project, .NET developers. .NET developers. So what is the .cs project file?
Visual Studio project.
It's the entire project file. A developer, he starts a project, a .cs project file is created. Code to code, line by line, every word can be seen. You have to just click on build, build a new app with another name, and you have a duplicate app with another name. Clear? Okay, so we'll quickly, I'll show you a demo. Okay, so Evan, I don't have a Windows Phone, so okay. I asked my friend, there was a Microsoft competition where you had to build a lot of apps, you know, and launch it so you get a free phone. So my friend had built all these applications and he got a free phone. I don't know, they're very pretty simple apps. I don't know if he duplicated it from somewhere. But anyway, so these are different apps. I thought I'll showcase it to you since it was his property. He said you can do it. So first step, any decompressor, okay? Open Archive. That's it. First step is over. Saw that? So simple. So to just try and open the exe. Use different tools. Decompressor works usually. For Android also it works. Okay. Very interesting point. I'll show you how I decompress the iOS file. Piece of cake. And I stumbled upon it even without using a tool. No tools used, I decompress the iOS. I'll show you how it is done. Okay. So .dll file for Windows Phone. Indian Railway Inquiry, okay. So I copied this file on my machine. It's right here. Okay. Now what do I do next? This is the object code. I have to find some translator which will give me the code, right? It was freely available, ILSpy. ILSpy is a tool which was available for free. I clicked on ILSpy, I downloaded it from internet. And here you go. So, okay, let me just delete this and show it to you fresh. You drag, drop Indian Railway Inquiry into it. Oh, sorry. That's it. Indian Railway Inquiry main function. So you have the PNR status which tells you if your seat is confirmed or not. Spot, time, etc. So this is not a very good app to demonstrate over here, but I didn't have any of the apps. So basically, if it was a Facebook app, you would have seen login or password check or chat, etc. Okay, so the main thing, important thing to notice, you click on any function and you can see the entire function over here. Function definitions. This is basically line by line written by a developer. Clear? So what do I do next? If I'm going to reverse engineer, so this is where my test case ends. Okay, I save it somewhere. Save code as, it is going to save as a, okay, not the entire, I need the entire thing. So file save, it's going to save as a .cs project. So you save it, I've already done that over here. So let me show you, decompile code. So this is the saved project, okay. Over here you can see, when you go inside this, you see all the .cs files. These are nothing but the code snippets, okay. Now what are the treasure words? Oh, it's there. Okay. Okay, so pass. Let me see if it's there. I don't know. Okay, there's no password over here. Key. Then okay. Fine. So you got the gist of it, right? So you have the application, you find the code and you search. We will go through. We'll find the treasures in Android. Don't worry, we have plenty. Okay, so okay, let's skip. How much time do I have?
20 minutes.
20 minutes. Okay, so reverse engineering Android. Okay. Technology Java. Read about it. Intermediate bytecode is called dex files. Okay. So you got two answers. Just googling it. What is assembly language? You get it. So the tools used are decompressor again, WinZip, piece of cake. Dex to jar is a tool which will be converting the bytecode to the, it's a translator. Okay, everybody with me? Okay, and the Java decompiler, because you get a jar file, you decompile it. Okay, so the steps, APK to dex. APK is executable for Android. Dex is the bytecode to jar and jar to Java. So you have the codes and then you can find the treasure words. Okay. The tools used are 7-zip open, command line dex to jar, which is open source, and JDGUI. So I'll show you the demo for this. Okay, so Palladian had, we have built a banking application just for this purpose. We usually showcase, if I go and train some client on how to secure an application, we use this app. It's available online. Okay, so this is the APK file. What do I do first? Now you have to help me out. I have to find the dex, right? Okay, so what do? I have to open this executable somehow. Okay, so the slide said? Unzip. So open archive. And there I see is classes.dex. Okay, there's one more way. If you're not read about the technology, okay, you don't find it anywhere. It doesn't say anywhere online that this is a bytecode or assembly code or whatever, intermediate code. How do you figure it out? Any hints? Anybody? How do you figure it out? Out of all the files that you have inside the exe, this is going to be the file.
Size.
Perfect. So this happens in iOS. You don't have an extension. Clear? So you have this dex. You see, it's the biggest size, etc. So I have unzipped it. Okay, and. I renamed it to palbang.dex, okay, so that I'm familiar with it. So I go inside, I copy this file, dex to jar tool, okay, so this is the command line tool which I'll be using. So let me delete the existing stuff. I paste it over here. Okay, now I have palbang, it's visible, right? Everybody can see it. So this is a command line tool, simple command. I open the command line over here. Very simple command, dex to jar. That's it. Dex to jar. Space. File bank. Or dex. Enter. I'm done. I have the decompiled jar version. Okay. Now, how did this dex to jar come into place? That's the first question. You have to understand how did it come into place. So, the developers who built it, they had given this. So most of the thing is available by the developers itself. They didn't compile stuff and they want to understand what is going on, etc. So these were a set of handy tools which are provided by Android itself. Yeah? Okay, so now I have this jar file. Okay. If I open this jar file in a RAR, WinRAR, I try WinZip. You will see all class files. All class files. Dot class files. Okay. So you see crypto? Okay, that's a banking app, DES. So you see this dot class files? Okay. So this is a Java, open source Java development environment. I have to somehow translate the dot class to the fourth step, Java, right? So the functions, basically class to functions, right? So there's a very handy free tool known as JDGUI, that's known as Java decompiler. It's a very super awesome tool. JDGUI for all Java based decompilations. So I open the tool. JDGUI. This is JD GUI. It says Java decompiler in the tab. Okay, so the next step is to drag drop. That's it. I've got the Java files of the class files. Everybody with me? So crypto.des, it has some ciphertext, DS engine. Just showing you the different ways that you can decompile, alert. Okay? Fine. So what do I do next? I save as, save all sources. It saves as a .zip file. Where do I store my dash? Okay, that's already present, okay? So I'm not bothering storing it. So this is the .zip file, okay? I extract it over here. Okay, it gives me all these assets, the above ones. Android manifest file, which is the permission file. If you're an Android developer, you must be knowing about it. Then the resources, then assets. Is this the icon? No, okay, let me just. Okay, so this is the one, sorry. Fine, so this is the set of folders, okay. Now what do I do? Treasures, the treasure keywords. So I start with pass. Come on. Okay, so I have all these files which have password written in. Okay. So very handy tool, Notepad++. Open all. Now this was a very good option which I had. You know, find in all open documents. Okay. So pass. Find in all open documents. Now it gives me a list below. So I just go through the all the lines and see which file has any vulnerable code. Okay, so here it goes. It says DB password equal to password. Okay, so the important thing to note over here is which treasure keywords you're looking out for. Okay, some people might rename this variable to mpin. You heard of mpin? The one, it's called pin in mobile interface. Sometimes the password is replaced with pins. Okay, so you have a transaction pin, etc. Okay, then you look for UDID. You see if it's storing anywhere, the UDID, the hardware ID of your phone. Okay, and let's go down. Okay, there's another data source password. Okay, so this is a live application that we have built for this purpose, to show you what can be the vulnerabilities. And mind you, I have found these vulnerabilities in live client applications. We have not just built it to showcase or something, show off. It's, we have found this in client applications. Clear? So pen testers, beware. Type equal to password, blah, blah, blah. I think password is over now. Let's go to some other. Let's look for key. Let's see if there's an E available. Encryption key. Okay. Control F. Key. Finding all open documents. Okay. So quickly browsing through. Okay, this is the key. Key, cool. So this is the cryptographic key, encryption key, DES. Clear? Everybody with me? So you know how to find treasures in a decompiled code. You know what is this case, and you know how to recommend this. Okay, yeah, excellent. Android and Windows Phone is done. So we'll quickly jump to the others. Those all. Okay. So. Slide. Okay. BlackBerry. How many of you are BlackBerry developers? BlackBerry has a good market. Come on. Okay, so BlackBerry, there are two different types of applications that you can build. Okay, so one is a basic .jar files, you know, any Java-based code that you write and it executes. The challenging part was the .cod files, .cod. It stands for code, that is code of BlackBerry, proprietary code of BlackBerry. This is a challenge. Is this a challenge? A jar can be decompiled, right? But can a chord be decompiled? I don't know. We'll have to check it out. Okay. So the chords were available. Okay. Whenever an application came, a dot jar would be triggered. Dot jar would be triggered. Sorry. And all these chords will come onto the phone. You take out the chords from the phone, and then you start opening it in Notepad. Okay. And all you see is jumbled text. All garbage. I'll show it to you. Okay. Before that, let me just go through the. Okay, so if you get a dot jar BlackBerry app, how do you decompile it? I just showed it to you. JDGUI. Cool. You open it directly, you'll get dot class files, and when you use JDGUI, you'll get function definitions. Clear? Everybody with me? Okay, so the Java part is over. So the other type of application is dot chord. Okay. So what happens is there's a dot jar file which gets downloaded onto the phone. Okay. And this gets all the chord files from the server and it runs. So there is a collection of 24-25 dot chord files. Okay, so it's very confusing, and BlackBerry tried its level best to give us a big challenge, and it was a very big challenge, believe me. So dot chord, BlackBerry code files. Okay, the steps, the first one was dot jar, use JDGUI, etc., open in Notepad or wherever. Okay, so this is the tool. Make note of this. The slides will be available online. So codec tool was something. A guy had built it. How did he do this? Okay, he knew that the developer was developing. Let's say I am developer. I knew that I was developing using a Java code. It's a Java environment. I'm using Eclipse. Okay, then how do these dot chord files come out? Okay, so they are adding one plugin inside the Eclipse which helps in generating these dot chord files. Clear? So basically, I have to understand that plugin and build a translator, reverse translator. That's all. That is it. Codec is that tool. Clear? So codec helps in retranslating the dot chord files to dot Java file. It was very difficult for me to find out this process. I wasted more than 8 man days on this, and finally I figured it out. Okay. So we'll see how a normal dot Java dot chord file looks like. BlackBerry. Okay, so this is how a dot chord package looks like. Okay, you can see the big set of dot chord files. It's very confusing. You open one, let's open one Notepad. That's it. So this is the garbage, and I had to test this out and with very limited time and figure out a decompilation. You cannot understand a thing over here. You know, in iOS, if you decompile the assembly language, you can at least see some words, you know, some English words, high level language words, but you have nothing. And this was like, oh, this is very, very big challenge. Okay, so I'm going to show you by using screenshots over here, because I don't have a dot chord application which is freely available online. So I had to keep some confidentiality over here, and I tried to build one on my own. I could not come up with a good one. So the first thing, first most important thing is the tool, that is the codec tool, codeccrab.exe. Okay, so you unzip this and you get two files. It's codec and doit.bat. So do it. You decompile it. So next step. See, these are all the set of dot chord files. It's hidden. So please bear with me. So dot chord files, you're pasting it in the codec folder. Okay. The next thing is you run the. It's a command line tool. So you run it. You say doit.bat space the bank palladium.chord. Okay. So it starts decompiling. That's it. That's all you have to do. You see this happening? Doit.bat star.chord. Okay? And it's decompiling the entire package. It's done. Okay? The next step. So you see this folder called decompiled at the top. This has the entire chunk. And you can see inside, if I just enumerated it. So the entire code snippet. So every chord file, there's a folder which has the code. Clear? So you go inside, you know, you dig deeper. You see banking app.java. Okay. You see the various libraries, the configuration, the data, the ciphered library. Everything is available. Okay. So I open one of the files in Notepad to show you real time view. Okay. So the decompilation process is clear. What I'm going to show is I have obfuscated certain things. So I have this backup with me. You see this? Okay. So we will be searching through these files for the keywords if they are present. Let me check. First keyword, pass. Okay, so there are many files with pass. Edit with notepad. Control F, pass. Okay, so. Is there a password? Nope, it's not there. Let's see if I. Okay, so similarly, you go through the each and every file. Okay, if I'm just running short on time, I want to go through iOS. Everybody clear with this? No doubts about quad files? Okay. So we'll quickly jump to iOS, which is the last demo for the day. Okay, the beauty of iOS. What are the extension for apps of iOS? Dot app folder? IPA with a certificate. Okay. So what did I do? How did I stumble upon it? Did you try opening the IPA in Windows? Anybody? All the developers, iOS developers? Okay, cool. Did you ever try opening the file in Windows? Yes. Okay, fine. So, the beauty, you open the file in Windows and it automatically decomposes.
So, Windows Explorer.
Okay, don't blame me. Okay, so go home and try this. Okay, the tools that I used are iExplorer. So, this is a very handy tool. It helps me browse through the iPhone contents or iPad contents. I'll show you the same. It will show each and every app. It will show the app folder. You download it onto your machine. The way I stumbled upon it was I use a Windows machine. So, okay. So, luck by chance. Windows Explorer. It's okay. OTool is a tool. Make note of this. Anybody knows what is OTool? If you are a developer, you'll know. OTool is a tool which is inbuilt. Xcode is a development environment. So the way you use Visual Basic for .NET, you use Xcode for iPhone apps. Clear with me? The way you use Eclipse for .jar, you use Xcode for iPhone apps. Okay, so that's why I tell you to read about technology. You know which tools you can try out. Okay, so OTool is an inbuilt tool, and there's class dump which helps in dumping the class file. Okay, so the first thing is dot app garbage object code. So you get the object code out of it, and I'll show you over here that you will not find the, there's no extension for the object code over here. That's why I was telling you. How do you figure it out?
Size.
The size. Okay. Then object code to class definitions by using some class dumping. Yeah. So let's quickly see Windows magic. Okay. Okay, I personally don't enjoy iDevices. The tool I was talking about, iExplorer. So there is a, this tool is available for free also, trial version, and the trial version is more than enough to do the work that we are doing today. So if you don't have a jailbroken iPad or iPhone, you have to use this technique. Okay, it crashes sometimes, so bear with me. Because it's a free version. Yeah. Okay. Come on. Okay, you see it has opened my iPad. The left hand side window, it says mobile. I'm trying to close this without getting. Okay, fine. Okay, so quickly let's read it before it closes. So you see various apps installed on my phone. Okay, so let's say I open com.facebook.facebook. Okay. Oh. Okay. Thank you. Okay, we are done. Just 5 minutes more. Can I take 5 minutes more? So what I'll do is, you can try this. It works. I don't know why it's not working. It takes some time. It gives a lot of trouble. So.
Don't you have an extractor backup on the system?
Yeah, I have a backup. So you see this. Now this is an example of Google Plus app. Okay, we have a Google Plus app on iPad. So this was the folder. Okay, I extracted the folder out of the iPad using iExplorer. I pasted it in Windows and it came out as this. I'll show you how you can view it in a MacBook. It'll show you a big X. You cannot open it. Okay? That's how it shows on a MacBook. But in Windows, it has given you the folder structure. So you open this and you see the .app file. Okay? Even this is you won't be able to open in a MacBook. Okay? So how do you find the file? The one with the largest size? It does not have a name, so usually one small hint is it will have the same name as the app. Okay, so it should be Google Plus or something. This is the app. Well, let's view the size. How do you go to the size?
Detail.
See this? 11 MB. Clear? So this is the exe2 object code. Okay. So you take this, you paste it in. Now the next step is you paste this in the MacBook, because you're going to use O-Tool, which is the tool in real 10 Xcode, developer for iOS. Okay, so okay, so I've already kept this ready because I knew I'd be short of time. So this is a RM workstation app, okay, which is an object code for an application which I downloaded. Let me see if I can show you that application. See, this is EMCA. Remember? Google Plus? So this is how it shows over here. So most of the iOS developers, they use Mac. So they don't know you can open this. Okay? So that's when they get fooled up.